Hey everybody! Today, Rotto runs through Sorcerer City, which is a new real-time competitive tile-laying game that's on Kickstarter right now. And I'm going to be doing a two-player run through today so you can see what it's all about. Although, before I get going, I strongly recommend you turn your subtitles onto the Klingon channel so that when I make rules goose, you'll know what they are. Okay, have you done so? And welcome to Sorcerer City, everybody. Although, it has yet to be built. Here is the dealio. This is a magical realm, and the city itself is comprised of all these tiles. And the interesting thing is, these tiles can tear themselves down and rebuild themselves every year. And that's the way the Denzians like it. Every year, and we're going to take over 5 years in this game, we are going to be rebuilding our little section of Sorcerer City and trying to lay it out to score as much magic, influence, money, and prestige as possible. And after we're done doing that in a real-time sequence, we will use the money we've got to buy more tiles and add them to our deck of tiles, kind of deck builder style, so that in the next year, we can once again tear it down and start rebuilding this magical city. Which all sounds great, except for the fact that every year, monsters are going to show up. In the first year, we don't have any, but at the end of year one, in this game, we're going to be plagued by dragons. And then at the end of year two, skeletons, pixies, and then at the end of year four, for our final year five, there will be goblins trying to steal our gold. Although there are other monsters as well, giants, krakens, dark mages, and chimeras who might bother us. Also, in each of the 4 years, there is a randomly chosen influence bonus that we can get that come from a deck of influence reward cards. Here's the ones that didn't make it in this game. So this year, there's a rainbow tile in the first year. In the third year, whoever gets this, all other players have to destroy one of their tiles. Oh no! So, I've got the game randomly set up, and each player gets their own scoreboard, their own starting deck of city tiles, and everybody's starting deck is exactly the same. And we also get our magic distribution cards, which we'll use a little bit later. Right, now, like I said, this is a real-time game. The real thing will come with a sand timer. I don't have that in my prototype today, so I'll just use my phone. The sand timer lasts for 2 minutes, which is what I've got my phone set for. And of course, you could use a phone instead of a sand timer, which gives you certain benefits like making noises and whatnot when time is up. But I am otherwise ready to go. Now, I'm here by myself right now, so I'm not actually going to be able to competitively build both my city and Jen's section of the city or Jen's suburb at the same time. So let's just move her stuff off the table and let's just have me focus on spending 2 minutes trying to build the best city I can. Now, everybody's supposed to take their stack of tiles and shuffle them up real good so that you don't know what order you're going to find these tiles in. And otherwise, we're ready to go. Now, this is definitely a game where everybody needs a fair amount of table space to build. In this first year, the city's not going to be very big, but over the course of 5 rounds, this deck could maybe double in size and your cities could start getting very, very large. But anyway, like I said, at the beginning of the game, it's super duper simple. Everybody knows exactly what they've got. This first year is almost just kind of like a warm-up to get your mind ready to go. And I'm going to show you how that works right now. As soon as I press start, I start flipping these tiles up one at a time and lay them down orthogonally adjacent to existing tiles as I expand my little section of the Sorcerer City. Now, these tiles all have one or more colors that represent the different resources that they generate. Green generates prestige, blue generates magic, yellow generates money, and red generates influence. And as I'm laying them down, I'm going to be trying to align them to score myself bonus points. Now, one thing that might be surprising to some people is, like I've got this one out, I place this. I do not have to place yellow on yellow. I am not bound at all. I could mix and match however I want, although of course it makes more sense to try to match colors and make bigger contiguous sections, but it doesn't matter unless I smartly use these bonus scoring tiles. These are the tiles that actually give me points. And I don't know what order they're going to be coming available to me, but I'm going to do my best to try and lay them down. And after I'm done, I'll show you how it all scores out. There's 3 different ways that I score points. By making big sections, big contiguous groups of the same color, or making a line of tiles that's the same color, or just putting those scoring shields next to each other, directly neighboring each other to try and score points. Right, so that's what I'm trying to do. Let's get going in 3, 2, 1, build. Okay, and so right off the bat, oh, I've got a shield. Now this is a shield that wants to be next to other shields, and there's all four colors coming out of it. My next one, okay, I'll just go on ahead and put this yellow here. Maybe I'll get some green matching up there, and I'll have this blue start going off in this direction. That's not bad. And let's see. Oh, now I could cap off the blue, but I don't want to do that. Let's go ahead and have start this yellow start building down in that direction. And let's see. Oh, so this is a yellow. This is a red tile. So this wants to be in a group of reds. So this is like a group of 1, 2, 3. That's a 3-pointer. Let's just go with that. That looks pretty nice. And let's see. Okay, now we've got another. Oh, I could have made this red bigger, but I can't now. Let's go on ahead and try to make a bigger green area over there. And then this red will never connect to that. All right, this is another. Oh, let's see. Let's go with this. Maybe I could go for another red contiguous area with this shield right here. Or do I want to put the shield over here and make a bigger green area? No, because this shield wants to be next to other shields for its bonuses. Hey, let's continue making a nice long blue line right there. Let's see. Oh, and let's go with okay, so the blue line has gotten a little bit longer, which is what this bonus wants. I got 49 seconds left. Hey, let's continue making a long yellow line because this is a yellow line score. And oh, all right, I'm almost out of tiles. Let's go on ahead and make this a bit longer. And finally, my last tile. All right, oh, this is the yellow group. All right, excuse me, Mr. Phone. Like I said, this game can take up a surprising amount of space. There we go. Now, I am done. I have built my suburb. Maybe not the best suburb in the world. We'll see how well it plays out. And now I just wait for everybody else. If everybody's done, of course, you can stop early. And like I said, this first round, you always have access to the same tiles. You don't know what order you're going to get them in, but it's a pretty simple, straightforward round. Let's go ahead and cancel. I say everybody's done. And score up. So each one of these bonus tiles scores me points, like I said, in one of three ways, based on groupings, lines, or adjacent shields. This one right here is a one that scores me blue magic points, and you can see it's showing tiles in a line. So this is a line bonus. What I do is I count up how long is the line that this is in of contiguous blues. 1, 2, 3, 4. That means this tile scored me 4 blue. Alrighty, let's look at the next one. This guy up here, now this is a tile that wants to be next to other bonus tiles. This is a shield bonus, wants to be next to other shields. So let's look at how well, and including diagonal, that can count. Although I didn't do very well with this one. This one wants to be next to other shields. There's next to only one. Now, for one of these shield bonuses to score, it has to be next to two other shields, which is not good. So this one scored me nothing because it's only next to one other shield. If I'd put a shield over here, it would score, but I didn't. So this one got me nothing. It would have earned me some influence, but I lost it. Let's move over to this one. This one is another one of these that wants to be next to shields. This generates me green victory points, prestige. It wants to be next to shields. It's next to two, so it does score, which means I get 1, 2, 3 blue. Alrighty, so I've scored 3 prestige. Let's look at this one. This is a grouping tile. It wants to have, it doesn't care what the shape is, just the more like colored tiles are in the group, the more points it's worth. Now this is 1, 2, 3 tiles that are in this little red grouping that are contiguous. It goes around this L, so that gives me 3 influence. Alrighty, and now this tile down here is, it's yellow, so it's generating money for me, gold. And it's another one of those lines, like this one over here. So I look at my line, 1, 2, 3, 4. So I got 4 money off of that. And now finally, this one down here is a yellow grouping one. So it wants a big group of yellow, which in this case is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That was a big one. A contiguous line, or not a line, but a contiguous group of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I just made 6 more gold. I had 4. That puts me up to 10. And my suburb is scored. How well did I do? I got 4 magic, 3 influence, 10 gold, and 3 prestige, which are the victory points of the game. Now, like I said, while I was doing this, all the other players were racing against time to build their own little towns. Now, I'm not actually going to build one for Jen, but let's just bring her score in. And I don't know, let's say that off on her side of the table, what was she building? All right, so let's say she scored only 3 magic and she got, I don't know, 5, and she only got 4, and she did much better on the points. Let's just arbitrarily, I'm just kind of making it up. She would have scored, she had the same opportunities, the same type of stuff, because she had the exact same tiles, but who knows what order hers came out in to determine what her city was going to be like. But let's say this is her final score. So now we are going to compare. The next step is everybody has magic. Jen ended up with 3, I ended up with 4. Each player has this little deck of raw magic conversion cards. And each of us is going to simultaneously choose what we want to convert our magic into. And what that means is, so I've got my 4 magic. I can't keep 4 magic. The magic doesn't do anything. I am now going to convert this magic into influence, money, or prestige, i.e. victory points. And I will, indicate which one I'm going to do by playing one of these 3 cards. And here's the thing. Right now, Jen and I are locked in a battle for influence, because whoever has the most influence gets 6 points, 6 prestige, and this bonus card. Who first place gets victory points and the bonus card. Second place gets victory points or the bonus card, one or the other. And third place, well, you don't get either of these. Instead, you get 5 coins, or you get 1 additional buy. Normally, during the purchasing phase, when we're going to purchase more and you'll kind of build up our deck of tiles, usually you only get to buy 2 things, but you could, if you have a lot of money, choose to buy 3 things instead. Now, wait a minute, I say first, second, and third place. How does that work? This is a 2-player game. There shouldn't be a third place, should there? Well, there is, because in a 2-player game, as part of setup, you grab one of these mystery player cards for your 4 and 5. There's a mystery player for each round. And now, the mystery player, we know he is going to have either scored 4, 7, or 10 influence. And so he might come in first, second, or third place. Now, he doesn't care. He doesn't take any bonuses, but we are competing with him. And so if either Jen or I wants to guarantee that we win this thing, we probably want to get up to 10. Because if we tie with him, in the case of a tie, everybody who ties gets that tiered reward. So if we can get up to 10, we're guaranteed to get the 6 victory points prestige plus the bonus card, as opposed to second place where it's one or the other. Now here's the deal. I genuinely earned 3. I didn't do very well on my red because if I had gotten this over here, let's say, then I would have had 1, 2 more red, but I would have had less blue. I would have had less magic. But I now have to decide, do I want to convert my 4 magic into 4 more red so that my score, my influence, will go from 3 to 7? If so, then I've brought a pretty good shot at least of coming in. Maybe I'll come in first, probably second. I won't come in last. Well, but again, we don't know what the dummy player's done. He'll either be 4, 7, or 10. Now, do I do that, or do I say to heck with it? I don't think, because, here's the deal. Jen's already at 5. She could put 3 more in, which would put her up to 8. Which means there's a chance that nobody will beat the mystery player, because the mystery player might be 10. He, like I said, he was random. Here's his other cards. It wasn't one of these. There's the 4, the 7, and the 10. We don't know which one he is. So both of us are having to decide. If I push my magic up here, it'll get me up to 7, which beats Jen right now. But what if Jen does the same thing? Then Jen's winning, and I will have wasted my magic. So should I instead say, to heck with it, I'm not even going to try, I'll just put my magic into more money so I can buy more valuable tiles, or will I put my magic into more victory points? Because victory points are what win you the game. Now, I don't think I'm that excited about getting 4 more victory points, because this is a game where you can easily score well in excess of 100, 150 points. This can be a hugely scoring game. So I don't think it makes much sense for me just to put 4 measly points over into green. So I'm definitely not going to play this card. Not that I'm telling anybody this. I'm making this choice in secret. Do I want more money so I can make a better buy for later? Or do I want more influence so I can buy for a better reward right now? Bird in the hand, bird in the bush. Or 2 in the bush is my choice here. Which one do I go for? Because again, I don't know what Jen's going to do. Do I feel lucky? Well, let's see. Looking at what she's got, I don't think she's going to put three magic over here into three victory points. She's only got $4. So three magic would get her up to $7. $4 is only going to let her buy one tile. So she has a very good reason to spend her three to get this up so that she has seven so she could afford to buy two tiles. Jen might be very, very tempted to do that. Again, I'm trying to get in her head and decide what is it that she is going to do. All right, I'm going to take a chance. I am going to go for it. I'm going to hope that Jen values getting more money than getting more influence right now so that she can make two purchases instead of one. So I secretly choose red. And let's see. Now, Jen, meanwhile, she thinks long and hard about it. And again, she, like me, she decides she's not going to do green because three magic to get three more points, not worth it. Later in the game, in a given round where you might have scored 20 or 25 magic, because this game scales hugely, then you might think, oh, yeah, I'll happily turn those 25 magic points into 25 prestige victory points. But let's see, what is Jen going to do? Jen has made her decision, okay? And everybody makes their decision. Everybody reveals. Here's my red. I'm hoping this puts me on top, banana. I'm hoping Jen went for money. No! She went for red as well. So Jen pumps her three magic, 1, 2, 3, into more influence. 1, 2, 3. That puts her at 8. I pump my 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Into 1, 2, 3, 4. And so Jen is winning the influence battle, but we're not done yet. Remember, there's still the mystery player. I have no idea what he's got, but let's go on ahead and shuffle him up. I want to be as surprised as you folks. I have no idea. Is he a 4, a 7, or a 10? All righty. And the mystery player reveals 7! Okay. So, hey, that means, well, first of all, Jen's very happy. If the mystery player had done the 10, then Jen would have come in second place. Jen is happy. She pumped it up. She got first place. That means she gets the 6 points and, in this case, the rainbow tile, which normally costs 8 money. Yay! So, Jen gets the sixer. So, she goes from 7 to 13. Boom. That's a nice little spread for her. And she adds one rainbow tile. Now remember, Jen's city is actually built somewhere over here. But anyway, so Jen's got a rainbow tile she's going to add to her city in future rounds. Boom. Now, second place. Hey, you know what? I had 7. The mystery player had 7. So we tied. If I'd had 6, then the mystery player doesn't take anything, but I would have come in last place, which means I would have just gotten 5 coins or initial buy. But since I tied for second place, it's my choice. Do I want 6 points or do I want a rainbow tile? I've only got 4 points. 6 points is nothing to sneeze at. That's actually pretty decent, but I think I value taking a rainbow tile, which costs 8 coins instead. So I've given myself a rainbow tile for tying the guy in second place. Now, if he had had his 4... it doesn't matter. I mean, since I tied, that was good enough. So that was it. We resolved all of that, and both Jen and I got a rainbow tile, but Jen also got a lot of extra points because she combined her magic and her influence and beat me out. But if I hadn't done that, if I hadn't put mine in, I would have come in last place, and I would have not gotten this sweet, sweet rainbow tile. Getting 5 purchasing points is not as good as getting an 8-point tile. But anyway, we are now done with the influence decision. Jen is the most influential sector of the city this round, which means Jen gets first dibs on shopping. But here's Jen's problem. Jen only has $4. She didn't give herself more money. So the tier ones all cost 3 or 4. The tier twos cost 5, 6, or 7. If I recall correctly, the tier eights cost 8, 9, 10, or 11. And then the tier fours cost 12 or more. And then the rainbows cost 8 a pop. So Jen can only afford one thing, a level 4. So she's going to spend all 4 of hers to buy, well, this costs 3, and then she'd waste that extra one. Or this one, which costs 4, or this one, which costs 4. I think Jen, now this is kind of a cool one. This one is a yellow tile, which means this can bump up her ability to make money in future rounds, if she goes for a money-making strategy. And every round when she uses this, this lets her get a 6-point tile for free every round for the rest of the game. So by getting this, Jen is effectively giving herself 1, 2, 3, 4 more tiles. So that's pretty cool. But on the flip side, this one is another way that Jen could score more. It's another line point, so Jen could score more money in future rounds. I think Jen's going to take this. So Jen, because she was first in influence, she buys first, and so this goes into her city as well. She could buy 2 things, but she's broke, so she can't buy any more. So Jen is done buying, the mystery player doesn't buy, and now it is my turn. And I did better on cash, didn't I? Yes, I do. I have 10 bucks to buy two things. Which means, wow, I mean, I could jump up into the tier three stuff, or I could buy a couple of tier one, tier two things. Yeah, baby. Oh, I like that. You know what I'm gonna do? You know what I'm gonna do? You know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna buy this tier two, which costs me five, and this gives me another opportunity to score magic points in lines. I already have one of these in my city, so now in a future round, if I build such that I put both of these next to each other, this would double my magic. And remember, magic is incredibly valuable for determining stuff. So I got that for five, and now I've got five left to spend. Any money I don't spend, I'm gonna lose, so I wanna spend it all. Let's see here. And so I bought that and revealed another one. Oh no, here we go. By the way, these aren't all supposed to be stacked up like this. They're all supposed to be in a single stack, but I'm just doing this just to make it easier for myself. So I've got five more bucks. So I could buy this, which is a two-sided, another opportunity to score group money, or I could buy this one that lets me get a tile for free every round, or, let's see, I've got $5 yet, right? Or this one, which lets me move a yellow. As you know, because maybe I get a yellow and it comes out at a time when it's not gonna really help me very much, and then later on, after I've made a nice big yellow group or whatever, I could move another yellow into position. So that's pretty cool. I could afford any of those things. Yeah, moving is cool, but you know what? Just scoring more money so I can buy more expensive stuff later is even cooler. I'm gonna take this other five pointer, and there goes my other $5. So I am done purchasing as well. Jen, she got a rainbow and a point score. I got a point score and a rainbow and, I've already forgotten something else. Oh, another one of, you know, 2 point scores, or a magic maker and another money maker and a rainbow. But on the flip side, Jen got almost three times as many points as I did this round. So now the last thing we do after everybody's done buying, and let's see, so another thing should have been revealed if there was a third or a fourth player buying. At the end of the round, we figure out, we figured out how many points everybody gets, and whoever got the fewest points, which in this case is me, gets a consolation prize in year one of another year one tile. In year two, a year two tile. In year four, a year four tile. So Jen scored a lot of points in this. I didn't really build her city, but let's just say she got a lot of points. I didn't get, so I get one more. Now I'll take this guy that I was eyeballing, the one that lets me move yellows around. And boom, the first year of four is done. This is out of the way. Oh, but there's one more thing. Dragons! Everybody randomly gets a dragon put in their deck. So I got that money slash, oh, what would you call it? Prestige dragon. Jen got the magic slash money dragon. So these go in our decks as well. And now we are gonna move on to year two, which means we shuffle our city back up and we once again have 2 minutes to build the best city we can. To score as many points in the four metrics as possible, but we have bigger cities now. In the first round, I mean, there is no way people are going to use all 2 minutes to build because it's so simple. But by the end of the game, like I said, your stack of tiles might have been twice as big as a start, and you will be desperately having to race against the clock. Only 2 minutes at the end of the game is nowhere near enough time. At the beginning of the game, it's more than enough time. But anyway, so I've got a slightly bigger deck by Jen, and so even though I've got more power here, I also have a bigger problem because I've got more work to do and potentially a trickier puzzle to solve because I've got more tiles to lay out effectively in my 2 minutes. And that, folks, is what Sorcerer City is all about. Now, here's the deal. That intro isn't really kind of, doesn't give you the full sense of just how crazy complicated this gets. So if you want, you can hit that I to go to the extended playthrough or follow the show notes. And what I'll do is I'll show you what a year five real-time sequence looks like. I mean, I'll just skip years 2, 3, 4, and 5. So that means when I get there, I'll have a really thick tile. I'll have a ton of monsters that give me trouble as I'm building, and I'll show you just how crazy complex it gets. If you just want to see that in the extended playthrough, or instead, you can go straight to final thoughts. Your choice in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.